in Pope's Herald, Boston. So if that's not the session you're here for, you can quickly just quietly walk out the back. If it is what you're here for, wonderful. My name is Michael Monestime. I am a graduate student at the University of Massachusetts, Boston in the Urban Planning Community Development Track. And today's agenda is really going to walk us through what is participatory planning, why it matters, and we'll give you a view into work that we've been doing over the past year in Pope's Hill, which is a neighborhood of Dorchester in the city of Boston. And through that, we'll walk through a brief history of Pope's Hill, how we came to be working with a local neighborhood association, how we created a scope of work and some framework around this participatory neighborhood plan. And then we'll start to delve into the data book and the good work that we're doing, that we're looking to complete by the end of this semester. Does that sound good for everybody?
Yes.
Wonderful. So we'll start by creating some boundaries. Boston, the city on a hill, Dorchester, and then this smaller, more targeted neighborhood of Pope's Hill. It's comprised of three census blocks, and a quick visualization of the boundaries and streets going clockwise is Victory Road, Houghton, Worrell, Pope's Hill, and Neponset Avenue, which is a busy retail corridor, Ashmont, and Adams Street. A quick snapshot on Pope's Hill, this very historic neighborhood. I grew up in the city of Boston. I had never heard of Pope's Hill. But now that we are doing some research, I'm honored that we're working within this neighborhood. Unbelievable amounts of history, as in most parts of Boston. But for Pope's Hill, the early history was European settlers who had come to Boston and were looking to make lives for themselves. And the reason why this neighborhood is desirable is close proximity to the Boston Harbor, its coastal regional surface, and it also has the Neponset River, which was great for trade. So as Boston starts to boom and people are moving out of these tight quarters and looking to expand into what was then the suburbs of Dorchester and Roxbury, the more affluent merchants were creating estates, and this is where their homes were, right? In addition to that, we had four families who were at the forefront of this Pope's Hill neighborhood, the Pope's family, which the hill is named after. You had the Mansfield family. You had a woman suffrage leader, Lucy Stone, and her husband, Henry Botwell, who all has streets named after them. How awesome is that? And Enoch Train, who had a steamship authority that took people from Boston to Europe, right? So these wealthy merchants had created these lavish estates. You had the Old Colony Railroad line, which was probably the first transit-oriented development that brought people to and from Dorchester's Pope's Hill neighborhood, in and out of the city of Boston, okay? That same railroad actually brought people to Rhode Island, where we are today. But over time, you saw this mass immigration of Irish immigrants, Irish Catholic immigrants, who came to Dorchester and settled it and made it home. So with that, you see the building of churches, the building of schools, and these larger parcels that were estates start to get broken down. Around the same time, there's this flux of a new housing stock, triple-deckers, which is sort of synonymous to the Boston area. 5,000 of them are built between 1880 and 1940, and with that, the neighborhood gets built out. So that's a quick little historic place. Pope's Hill today is a half a square mile, 16,000 working-class, middle-income Bostonians live there. They come from different cultural backgrounds. They all call it home. It has a mix of single-family, triple-decker, small-scale apartment housing units that are all well-served by local schools, playgrounds, parks, transit, and two very active neighborhood retail-oriented corridors. So, in creating this opportunity, we did it through partnership. Around this time of 1948 is the formation of the Pope's Hill Neighborhood Association, a group of folks who lived in the neighborhood who really cared about their neighborhood, who wanted to see the neighborhood keep its character. And while there's a lot going on, also wanted to maintain being and having a seat at the table. Early on, participatory planning, right? So 1948, the Pope's Hill Neighborhood Association is created to address private disinvestment, housing deterioration, decline in municipal services, and highway encroachment, all within this working class neighborhood. They're responsible for a number of highly valued infrastructure projects, youth recreation, and cultural programs. And more recently, the Folkestone Neighborhood Association has focused on opposition to spot upzoning, which is causing traffic congestion, escalating housing costs, which is happening all throughout the greater Boston area, and is threatening to change the character and fabric of this neighborhood that has remained predominantly Irish Catholic over these generations. So in comes the opportunity and a group of scrappy, excited planners from the University of Massachusetts Boston. And we had reached out to local and private public agencies to try to find a scope of work or an opportunity where we could do our design and planning studio. It was through UMass Boston's Director of Community Relations, this wonderful, wonderful gentleman, Phil Carver, who suggested Folkestone for three great reasons. One, the development pressures that the neighborhood was facing through the spot upzoning, the level of local citizen organization. Most importantly, the residents were interested in planning, right? I don't think that happens all the time, but it was great that these residents were really interested in planning. And then to cap it off, its proximity to UMass Boston, less than a half a mile away, really allowed for students who work during the day, take classes in the evening and at night, have this opportunity to engage and learn a neighborhood that had long been in my backyard, but unbeknownst to me. With that, we set some criteria, as you should with all planning initiatives, and it was really focused around planning goals. We worked to formulate an anti-displacement-focused neighborhood stabilization plan, build a more broad-based and inclusive Folkestone Neighborhood Association, so not only the local actors who traditionally have a seat at the table, but how can we go a little deeper and make sure that all members of the community do have a seat at the table and part of this inclusive process. Enhancing organizing, planning, and development capacity of CBDOs servicing the Post Hill neighborhood. So with that, we had a great scope of work, and we had to go in and we had to pitch the Neighborhood Association and all of the residents to see if this reflected what they wanted to see done in a neighborhood-based plan. So in the basements of UMass Boston, we hatched such a great idea, a list of services that included establishing a representative steering committee outside of just the Folkestone Neighborhood Association, again, making sure it was inclusive for all. A complete archival research of Folkestone history, which we will tease out and give you a view into today. Study the population, the economic and housing trends using US Census data that's readily available at our fingertips with today's technology. Undertake a physical survey of existing neighborhood conditions through some windshield surveys. Conduct interviews with local institutional leaders and residents. We got invited into people's homes. We got to learn what they loved and hated about the neighborhood, and that all became part of the plan. And convene focus groups with underrepresented groups. Organize community goal setting events, and ultimately engage residents in issue-specific action planning. And to cement that off, our data book, our work, our end of semester, a year's worth of service to prepare a 10-year neighborhood preservation plan for the Boston Planning and Development Agency to adopt for this neighborhood. That's what we were interested in. What we were not interested in as part of this partnership was a shelf plan, right? A study for the sake of a study, or engaging in participation as part of a performance act. So at the same time where we're defining the criteria for this work together, similarly, Mayor Martin Walsh is out creating the Imagine Boston 2030 plan, which we have studied as planners, as participatory community development planners, through a lens of how much of that is the Dr. Pony Show, and how much of that is real community engagement. So we studied how they reached out to neighborhoods and got neighborhoods involved. Was the communication in multiple languages? Was it done within every mom and pop barbershop or beauty salon? Or was it more of performance art? Not only that, when we attended those meetings, which we did, we also studied how those meetings were facilitated. What could we learn, the do's and don'ts, from the way that these meetings were held. How do we sort of take the information that's gathered today, and we're going to have all of you do some participatory work for us, so we'll gather that information, and then again, how does that make the final claim, right? So at each stage, is the community really involved? Is their voice, is their seat really at the table, and is what they communicated really part of the claim? So that's what we were looking to do, and we framed it with this question to ourselves: how do we move up the ladder of citizen participation in Boston, given its long history of top-down planning, right? So what we see here is an illustration of ladder of civic participation by Sherry Arnstein. And this is more of the traditional planning approach. I hope none of us here are sort of falling in line with this. I hope you all go back to your communities, your local towns, your regions, and do more of a participatory planning approach for your next developments. But here, we see manipulation, placation. And what we wanted to change around the narrative was, how do we inform them? How do we consult? How do we create partnership? How do we delegate that power and turn it over to citizens for them to have control? This is the neighborhoods they live in. These are the streets they drive down. This is where their kids go to school. It's very important for them to be part of this process. And what we did was embrace a participatory action research approach to neighborhood planning, okay? So with that, diagnosing and problem formulation, action planning, action taking, so the design work, how do you design from a plan, the impact evaluation and reflection and learning. And to keep this on a time frame, I'm gonna stop now and turn it over to one of my classmates, Rochelle Hall, who will start to walk you through some of our data, some of the framework, and sort of the next steps we took on this initiative.
Good morning. So he's tough to follow. He's our star. So I'll try to do my best here. But yes, my name is Rochelle Hall. Good morning. Thank you for joining us on this rainy morning. So in collecting the information, one of the first things we did was field observation, or windshield survey, we like to call it, where we would drive around the neighborhood and just take initial observations or get out and walk the street a little bit. So this started in February of 2017, this year, and just some of the takeaways just was that it's a predominantly residential neighborhood. The day that we visited, there was a large snowstorm before, but it was interesting because all of the sidewalks were clear and the streets were clear, so there's excellent municipal services within the boundary of Hotel. There's narrow, covered streets, it's car dominated, but there are traffic issues, which we'll all talk about. And as far as the housing stock goes, it's older, you know, it's post World War II, but it's good, it's in good condition. With some spots, you know, there's abandoned housing along the corridor that we need to do a little more research on and figure out what's going on there. But for the most part, it's in good condition. So continuing on that, if you take a look at the typology, it gets its name because there is actually a hill within the boundary. You can see that triangle that Nicole described right there, and that circle there is where the hill is. And actually at the summit of the hill, it overlooks Dorchester Bay. So if you're familiar with driving in Boston, if you're on 93, you know the gas tanks to your right. So at that summit, you have a view of the gas tanks and UMass Boston really clearly. So it's quite a large hill, really like street pattern, and hilly, again, steep sections of the neighborhood. Cul-de-sacs, a mix of one and two-way streets, sort of an odd layout with, you know, I'm not sure that there was enough planning initially to sort of look at the overall layout of the neighborhood with the mix of the one and two-ways, which makes it difficult for the driver. And again, most of the homes, you'll see these retaining walls because of the hill that exists. So, along with the residential uses, there's a variety of commercial and institutional and recreational uses. And these are pictures of the church. It's a, you know, we've got St. Anne's Catholic Church, there's St. Brennan's nearby, there's a Baptist church, there's a Haitian church, there's two private schools, Pope John Paul Catholic, and then a private charter house school within the neighborhood. So again, it's sort of a strong civic fabric in the neighborhood, which makes the community well organized. And a look at the housing structure, again, it's post-World War II double, triple decker that you see in and around Boston. Older housing stock, multifamily, single family, several dilapidated multifamilies in the neighborhood along the periphery, though not so much inside the boundary. And as far as you know, the information that we've gathered, it's non-resident owners that have these dilapidated properties. So another step within the process is looking at the demographic data, the census block data. And so the population here within the 15-year period that we looked at from 2000 to 2015, there was a gradual increase. It peaked in 2015 at about 3,604 people, which is a 6.5 increase from the year 2000. And as you'll see, particularly within the upper block group, it increased by 28%, while the lower two block groups shifted and decreased. And this means that there's greater density housing within the upper block group. And also, the other thing, the fact that there is greater density or population in the upper block group is possibly a suggestion that the development coming from the city of the center, with the new business activity and growth that's happening in Boston and, you know, other metropolitan cities, is the neighborhood is now seeing the effects of this. It's coming down from Boston and looking at the racial characteristics, again, between the same time period, white population looks to decrease by 30%, the African-American population increased by 4%, and the Asian population increased by 25%. And again, the upper census block area you can see is much more heavily populated with the minority populations, whereas the lower block groups have a slightly higher concentration of the white population. Median household income. So what we did here was just quickly, the dark blue dotted lines here within our triangle are from a map of 1874 where Michael was mentioning the large lot parcels. So you can see how it was divided up into very large lots at that time. And there were about a dozen large landowners who were the well-known merchants of the time. By 1904, more development occurred, which is shown in green. You can see there's more parcels. And then by 1933, the majority of the neighborhood had been developed, which is shown in light blue. And then the missing part is what happened, you know, probably, we believe, around, you know, World War II. But Dichotomy Valley is definitely a useful thing, I think, in planning to show the development history. So here's a typology or land use map we have here. So it has a wide mix of housing styles. There's a large concentration of triple deckers, which are shown in red. The two-family housing is shown in pink. And the green shows the colonial-style housing, which is mostly single-family, but there could be two or multi-family within that as well. But the main takeaway here is that it's lifelong housing within the neighborhood. Provides residents really a number of options. And finally, in this section, the zoning of the area is entirely residential, which is interesting because there are commercial businesses along the boundary streets, the corridors, but there's no commercial zoning that exists that we can find in the Boston data. So here we see that the zoning needs to be adjusted, and I'm not sure. It's hard to tell when it was last done, when Boston actually made an effort within this area to look at those things. So with that, thank you for your time. I will turn it over to my colleague, Patrick McKenna.
Good morning, guys.
Good morning.
So my name is Patrick McKenna, and I'm going to be going over the survey data that we collected from as well. So the following results that I'll be sharing today are all based on in-person surveys. Collected over the last few months, my colleagues and I, while we canvassed neighborhoods, walking door to door, being welcomed into neighbors' homes, sitting with influential leaders in the neighborhood, as part of our stabilization plan. Rather than sitting in the basement of UMass Boston and hatching our own neighborhood stabilization plan that we thought might fit, we decided to utilize the participatory action approach for planning, and thought that the best sources of local knowledge are the residents. We also wanted to take our canvassing as an opportunity to make a personal connection with the residents. We wanted to learn from them and welcome them into the neighborhood planning process. We set out over the course of numerous weekends, weekdays, this past summer. We broke the neighborhood into sectors and divided into teams of two, and we set off and did our interviews. We learned a lot from the residents, from the process, about ourselves, about our capacity, and we learned that it's tricky to go door knocking in the summer, especially the week after Verizon's campus neighborhood. Thus far, we've been able to have meaningful conversations with 42 residents from throughout the neighborhood. We've also been able to complete detailed interviews with 10 institutional leaders from the neighborhood. And over the remaining course of the semester, we will hit the streets again and gather more responses from residents and sit with as many institutional leaders as possible. So here are the preliminary results. When residents were asked, what are the three things that they like best about living in Hopesville? Their responses were friendly neighborhood feel, a sense of community, and a convenient location, both in the city, both close to the city and close to the highway. It was also safe and quiet. When residents were asked what are the three things that they liked least about living in the coastal neighborhood, their responses were narrow streets creating traffic and parking problems, the threat of increased development coming from other parts, the periphery parts of the neighborhood, following data is actually from institutional leaders. When asked from their organization's perspective, what the neighborhood's most important assets, resources, and attractions were, we got answers like there's a strong sense of community in the neighborhood, that people take pride in the neighborhood, and that there's a high level of family engagement with a community center, with the kids at school, and other activities outside, extracurricular activities. When asked from their organization's perspective what the neighborhood's most important challenges were, we got answers that they mentioned unwanted neighborhood development encroaching in onto the neighborhood, that they feared becoming an XLB, an XL Boston, where it's heavily gentrified, and they feared rising housing costs. When asked how they felt about the Boston Planning and Development Agency's, how their recent upzoning has affected the neighborhood, we got a less strongly negative response than the residents. And so we got answers from them ranging from that they didn't want to be perceived as being anti-development, and that they understood that there's both good and there's bad development, but that they felt that the neighborhood development needed to be viewed in a comprehensive way, because otherwise it would continue to leave residents feeling fearful and threatened. And when asked if local residents and city officials, take no action to stabilize or improve the coastal neighborhood over the next 10 years, what impact they thought that would have, we had a strong response that they thought that it would have a detrimental impact on the neighborhood, and that the neighborhood would experience deterioration. And they felt that the neighborhood needed safeguards in place to help harness the new development and ensure that it was done in a respectful way that respected the residents' wishes. And so with that, I'm going to hand it off to my colleague, Noah Augustine.
Thanks, Pat. My name is Noah Augustine. I'm another graduate student at UMass Boston, focusing on the environment. And I'm going to talk today about some of this data and our initial interpretation of that data. Working within the bounds of a semester, we are a little bit rushed in the timeline, and we're trying to formulate some initial findings to then reflect to the community and ask whether we've analyzed the data correctly and whether we've sort of covered our bases in terms of understanding the neighborhood. So this very recent SWOT analysis was just developed. This is us reflecting on the survey data, the demographic data, mapping data, and trying to pull together a cohesive set of opportunities and threats to address in the planning process. So as you can see, we found a very sort of universal set of strengths that people mentioned about the neighborhood. Those included a sense of community, sense of safety and sense of character in the neighborhood, and sort of convenience of living close to the city. Weaknesses were perceived often to be related to increased densification, so things like traffic, to begin moving forward and bring to the community some initial solutions to get them thinking about what they think would address these problems, we focused on three main themes. Those themes include the traffic and parking in the neighborhood. So looking at what we could do as a policy measure, as a planning measure, to address these narrow, crowded streets. And then the second issue is zoning. So looking at what the Boston Planning and Development Agency is proposing for the neighborhood, looking at what would make sense to the people in the neighborhood in terms of increasing the housing stock in infill development. And then the third issue was increasing the communication methods and strategies institutional leaders and across the neighborhood as a whole were using within the community. We noticed that there was a lack of inclusion of different populations, especially those who were recent immigrants or had moved into the neighborhood in the recent past. So trying to find a way to increase outreach to those populations. So some of our strategy brainstorming included trying to find solutions that kill two birds with one stone, or preferably five. So we looked at these in the lens of policy solutions, technical planning solutions, and larger community, sort of community-based changes that could happen. These are some of our ideas in terms of zoning, we need to recommend an overlay district regulating the housing development in the neighborhood to keep it more in character with current housing. And then things for communication, like developing a more accessible community website for sharing things across the neighborhood and building more connections between neighbors. The SWOT analysis that we completed, we're going to show the community soon and then incorporate their feedback into creating a visioning session for them to really do this type of work and propose their own solutions. So, here's the fun part. So, we're talking a lot about community involvement in the planning process and participation, and so we'd like to actually ask you to also participate in this process. You've now been given a lot of information that we found in our initial research, and we're hoping that you can help us as assistant planners to complete some brainstorming, just really disguise the limit kind of exercise, and focus on one of those three issues that we just talked about. So solutions to address traffic and parking, solutions to the zoning issues, or communication strategies. So the mapping exercise, we have four different tables with a map of the community on it. And we'd love for, as you're able to, with a larger group than we thought, to divide and choose at your table one issue that you'd like to address, whether it's the zoning, the communication, or the traffic issues. And look at the map and actually try to come up with your top three ideas about what to do in this neighborhood. It could be a policy, it could be a planning implementation measure, it could be a community-based initiative. We're going to ask you to appoint a reporter to report these back to us and then place them into this template. So we're looking at medium-term solutions, so things that are quick and easy, that mostly take volunteer effort, and that the neighborhood could realistically break ground on tomorrow. So something that would fall into that is having a volunteer create a website. Something relatively inexpensive could happen right away. Then short-term solutions. So 3 to 5 year planning process might include changes in zoning, might include new volunteers or part-time main staff of the civic association. Could include things like running community programming in the parks. Or long-term solutions. So these are more substantial solutions in the neighborhood. Requires new legislation, new full-time staff, and would really represent a significant change in the neighborhood. I think the four tables are here, and then other tables have paper, shellar sheet paper. If you'd like to get started, we're here if you have a question. We'd like you to spend maybe a minute or two doing a quick round of introductions at your table, and then even if you don't have paper, just try to think of your top three ideas for what to do as a neighborhood given